like rocks, especially pretty rocks, and we also like categories. So it should come as no surprise that somewhere, someone thought it was a good idea to assign a bunch of the prettiest rocks to the months of the year. The history of birthstones actually traces back more than a millennium through multiple religious traditions, and the tradition of associating them with the months of the year goes back centuries. But most of the month and gem pairs that get brought up when people talk about birthstones come from a list created by the Jewelers of America in 1912. And even though the list probably began as a marketing tactic, people love their birthstones. Well, a lot of people do. Anyway, others wish they'd been born just like a few days later. But while most people love them for what they represent, a lot of the birthstones have actual practical uses. So let's run through all 12 months of the year and see which stones do more than look pretty. The most famous color of January's stone garnet is a deep blood red, but it can come in quite a few colors. And just like those color options, garnets are versatile when it comes to applications. But before I get into any applications for any birthstone, I should note that a lot of the time, lab-grown is best. A lot better than anything you'd take out of the ground. They're predictable, cheap, can be made with certain color properties, and can be guaranteed to come out flawless, which is often crucial. But sometimes you can get away with the stuff you get out of the ground. Natural garnet works just as well for our first application, filtering water. That's because garnet is a relatively hard material, which helps make it super durable and resistant to erosion. You can also make it into very, very small grains, so you can filter out teeny tiny particulates. Garnet water filters can remove particulates down to 10 to 20 microns. For context, that's contaminants between the sizes of red and white blood cells. These gemstones are also used in devices called scintillation detectors, which are used to detect ionizing radiation, the kind of radiation we usually, you know, worry about. They're so well suited for this task because they glow if you hit them with a lot of radiation. And to round out our list of garnet applications, we can use them in some specialized lasers. But there's another birthstone with a much closer relationship with that tech, so you're going to have to wait until July for that discussion. For now, we'll move on to February. Next up, we've got amethyst, which is an admittedly lovely gemstone. It's my birthstone. But as far as practical uses go, it doesn't seem to have all that many. That said, amethyst is a type of quartz, which is very useful. I mean, it's in everything from countertops to insulation to clocks. Plus, quartz has piezoelectric properties, which means it can generate electricity when you apply some kind of mechanical stress. But amethyst itself doesn't have a lot of unique use cases. We did find one paper from 2011 which proposed amethyst ore could be used as a radiation shield because we know amethyst absorbs ionizing radiation. In fact, that's actually what turns the crystals purple. But so far, that paper was an isolated proposal. For now, us February babies will just have to be content with those massive amethyst geodes they stick in museums and that your cool aunt has in her living room. March's gemstone aquamarine might share its name with an iconic movie mermaid, but it isn't much different from amethyst when it comes to usefulness. Aquamarine is a type of beryl, which is mostly useful as a source of the element beryllium. And beryllium is one of those elements that's found all over modern tech. The metal is pretty scratch resistant and it stays pretty stable at a range of temperatures, so it's great for some very high-tech applications. For example, it's what we use to make a bunch of the pipes we accelerate all the particles through in the Large Hadron Collider, and it's what we made the mirrors on the James Webb Space Telescope out of. Beryl is also a carcinogen, meaning it's cancerous if inhaled, so maybe leave collecting the beryllium in it to the professionals. Next up is April. In terms of gemstones, diamond is about as useful as you can get. There's no way we're getting through even a fraction of its uses in this video, so we're going to have to settle for highlighting a few particularly cool ones. Most famously, diamond is the hardest material that occurs naturally on Earth. For a long time, it was the top of the hardness scale, period, although some recent developments have called that into question. Regardless, diamond is incredibly hard, which makes it great for things like drill bits, files, and specialized cutting tools, but there are even cooler applications like anvil cells. First created in the 1950s, anvil cells are devices that scientists use to generate massive amounts of pressure in highly localized environments, allowing them to study the effects of intense pressure. At their absolute basic level, diamond anvil cells consist of two diamonds, a sample, and, for lack of a better word, a smushing apparatus that the diamonds sit in. The diamonds are each cut into that stereotypical diamond shape, but with the little point flattened out. And then they're placed into the smusher, non-point to non-point. Once everything is in place, the sample gets placed very carefully between the two gems. And the researchers channel their inner Queen and David Bowie. This is an under-pressure joke. As pressure is applied to the wide top faces of the diamonds, it essentially funnels down and gets concentrated at the little non-pointy surfaces. This generates massive amounts of pressure right between those two surfaces, like core of the earth type pressures. Now, diamond isn't the only material that scientists use to make anvil cells, but it does have one major advantage. Light passes through it. That means with a diamond anvil cell, you can see inside your experiment the whole time you're running it. Pretty cool bonus. It also means that, if you want to, you can shoot the whole contraption with lasers to heat the sample and see what that does. Good thing diamonds can also handle a lot of heat. But diamond anvil cells are old. Is there anything new that diamonds can do? Well, yeah. The newest of the new, in fact. As it turns out, diamonds might be great for quantum computing. If you go into the molecular structure of a diamond, replace one carbon atom with a nitrogen atom, and leave a neighboring atom spot blank, you get what's called a nitrogen vacancy center. Electrons can then temporarily fill the slots in that gap and interact with the carbon atoms in the rest of the diamond. This allows both atoms and electrons to function as the quantum computer's version of bits, called qubits, while the diamond lattice holds the whole thing together. And while you might not think the words diamonds and affordable go together, this actually might be a fairly inexpensive solution for creating a quantum computing system that keeps working for an extended period of time, and at room temperatures too. So honestly, when it comes to a diamond, the better question is, what can't it do? Anything is going to be a step down in usefulness from diamond, but maize emerald is kind of a big one. Emerald is another type of beryl, so it has all the cool aspects of other beryls, and it can be used in lasers, but it's, from what we can tell, not all that popular. But that's, kind of it. It sure is pretty, though. Next! June's birthstone is pearl, and to be honest, pearl is kind of a weird one in the usefulness department because they're definitely useful to the animals that make them. Pearls are made when a creature surrounds an irritant with a smooth substance over and over again to protect itself from cuts and other forms of damage. They can even do this to whole fish, which just looks wild. But for humans, the practicality of pearls is a bit less straightforward. People have long suspected that they might have health benefits, which actually applies to a lot of the gems on this list. Across time and cultures, humans tend to think pretty and beneficial go hand in hand. For example, traditional Chinese medicine has used pearls for millennia, but there's little to no significant modern Western evidence that supports medicinal use. That said, June doesn't have to count itself out of the useful Olympics entirely, because it has an alternative birthstone, alexandrite. And alexandrite has a few more applications. Alexandrite is a super rare form of chrysoberyl, which, despite its name, is not a type of beryl. Its most common scientific use case is in lasers, specifically dermatological ones. Alexandrite lasers are very commonly used in things like laser hair removal, tattoo removal, and leg vein treatment because the light it produces gets absorbed by the melanin in our skin so well. And on top of that, there's even some experimental alexandrite laser usage in dentistry. Not bad, June. And now that we've hit the halfway point in the year, we've got to keep the lights on with an ad.
This SciShow video is supported by Jump, the statistical analysis software trusted by the largest pharmaceutical companies, consumer products companies, and semiconductor companies in the world. Pharmaceutical companies use Jump to help them speed up drug development. After all, that's kind of their goal. Jump supports them while designing experiments, keeping up with regulations, and understanding their data. Plus, Jump helps them keep costs low. When manufacturing drugs, they can work with Jump to reduce the number of batches that fail. And while conducting clinical trials, Jump can help keep them efficient to reduce costs too. If you're a young professional in the pharmaceutical industry or countless other industries, you can visit jmp.com/scishow to reap the benefits of visual statistics for yourself and get a 30-day free trial.
July's birthstone is ruby, aka the red version of a mineral called corundum. And this is another mega useful gemstone. It's also where we're finally gonna talk about lasers, because rubies and lasers are deeply intertwined throughout scientific history. In fact, the very first laser used a ruby crystal. Lasers work by taking advantage of what's called stimulated emission. So let's unpack that a little bit. Atoms generally want their electrons to exist in the lowest energy level possible. I mean, as much as atoms can want anything, anyway. But if you blast them with photons that have just the right amount of energy, that is, light that is just the right color, those electrons will absorb that energy, get excited, and jump up to a higher energy level. Then when the electron eventually sheds that energy to drop back to its base level, it has to emit its own photon. This process is called spontaneous emission. To achieve stimulated emission, you basically have to get your atoms to stay excited long enough by shooting them with even more photons through a process called pumping. And when they drop back down to the ground state, they'll produce more than one photon of the same wavelength, amplifying whatever photons were originally blasted into the system. But this pumping is only possible in certain materials, specifically ones where you can tune the energy levels so that they absorb and emit photons of the right wavelength. If your material doesn't work that way, you can't pump it and you can't make it amplify light like a laser does. Lucky for ruby lovers, the gem works perfectly for this. However, lasers are far from the only place you'll find rubies doing actual work. For example, they're sometimes used in watchmaking. Corundum in general is super hard and doesn't generate a lot of friction, so rubies can keep metal parts from wearing each other out. They also fluoresce or glow differently under different pressures. This allows them to be used with all those diamond anvils from earlier to measure exactly what the pressure is inside the diamond cell. I could go on, but July's had enough time in the spotlight. Peridot might be the most controversial birthstone. Some August babies love it, some hate it, and some grew to hate it less after they learned more about the science related to it. Peridot is a nicer version of one of the most common minerals in Earth's mantle, olivine. So it's useful for all of the reasons any other kind of olivine is useful. It's been found in meteorites and on the moon, so scientists can study those samples and tinker with Earth olivine to better understand planetary science more generally. But olivine is also useful in certain industrial cases, like steel manufacturing. It's even been proposed for use in electric vehicle battery cathodes and even carbon sequestration, which is the process of pulling carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. So from the August babies who worked on this script, thanks, Peridot, for being the more useful of the two green birthstones. Just like ruby, September's birthstone sapphire is a type of corundum. In fact, pretty much all corundum that isn't red gets labeled sapphire, so it should be no surprise that sapphires have a bunch of different uses. There's a whole class of these things that are just referred to as silicon on sapphire. As the name suggests, they're made by growing a very thin layer of silicon on top of a thin piece of sapphire. Meanwhile, sapphire is also used in some fancy timepieces, but for a different reason than their ruby siblings. White sapphire can be cut in such a way that it basically functions as super durable glass. People use it as watch faces to protect all the delicate gears inside. You know, in case you whack your wrist against a chair you thought was a little further away, which I have never done. Some scientists are even looking into replacing the glass of smartphone screens with sapphire, but that's not even the most high-tech application. By combining sapphire substrate, see-through optical materials, and high-tech gadgetry, you can make the thinnest lenses in the world. They're just a few atoms thick, and one day they might be used in the pinnacle of augmented reality eyewear. Personally, I'm going to avoid any tech that reminds me of the Google Glass days, but I'm sure someone else is going to love it. And anyway, I am way more interested in October's entry. If you know anything about gemstones, you might not think that opal would be very useful. It's not super durable or super clear, which are the two main properties that make most gemstones useful on their own. But with opal, the lack of clarity is the whole point. Opals are natural versions of what are known as photonic crystals. And to explain what that means, I need you to picture something with me. You know when you put a straw in a glass of water and it looks like the straw bends? That's because air and water have different refractive indices, meaning that light travels through them at different speeds. Photonic crystals are special because their refractive index changes periodically throughout the material. Their crystalline structures have little holes in between particles, and those little holes have different refractive indices than the rest of the structure. And every time a ray of light enters a different medium with a different refractive index, a portion of it bounces off instead of getting bent. In a natural opal, this scattering leads to all the sparkly colors you see. But if you build a version of a photonic crystal very carefully in a lab, you can control how all those little scattery bounces work. And if you're very careful, you can even get all the reflected light to add together. This behavior has earned artificial photonic crystals a reputation for being incredibly good mirrors. So good, in fact, that some can reflect more than 99% of the light that hits them. Scientists have used them in things like surgical laser scalpels and solar cells to make them more efficient. But based on early research, they might also prove useful for telecommunications for the same reasons. Now, technically, a lot of this tech is still fairly cutting edge, pun intended, but it doesn't seem like we'll be seeing the end of opal's usefulness anytime soon. November has a few options for its birthstone, but we're going to focus on topaz. It has a few applications, one of which requires very specific circumstances. Very, very hot. Specific circumstances. Topaz is heat resistant, hard, chemically stable, and wear resistant. So slabs of the material are super useful in things like kilns and furnaces that are basically mega heat containers. You can also mix it into substances like cement to give them a boost in the direction of topaz's cool features. And on top of all that, it might also be useful in dosimetry, which is the process of detecting radiation. So the uses are pretty niche, but topaz is definitely useful. And last but not least, we have December, another month with a bunch of birthstone options, which thankfully lets us skip over turquoise because honestly, that would be a bit of a flop to end on. Lapis lazuli is one of the month's birthstones, which has been used as a stunning pigment throughout history. But we're gonna focus on zircon, because zircon is where it's at for uses. It's used in high heat environments like topaz, but even more extreme ones. And much like beryl is the source of beryllium, zircon is humanity's primary source of the metal zirconium. Zirconium is used to make everything from ceramic knives and sandpaper to vacuum tubes, old photography flash bulbs, and nuclear reactor fuel pellets. But I would argue that zircon's coolest use is in planetary science. Because zircon is super robust, its crystals can withstand billions of years of geologic processing. The rocks surrounding tiny zircon grains may change, but the zircon itself doesn't. The oldest zircon crystals we've found are roughly 4.4 billion years old. Our planet is 4.5 billion years old. So zircon doesn't just provide a window to the earliest moments of Earth's history, it helps geologists track the evolution of our planet, how it got from a ball of molten rock and metal to what it is today. Not bad for a relatively boring looking gemstone, if you ask me. Well, not bad for the whole list, if we're being honest. It's pretty cool that birthstones can do a lot more than adorn our rings and necklaces. Although, a few of them do look pretty good on a shelf displaying samples from the SciShow Rocks Box collection.